Hi everyone, I'm Nathan with No Sleep Till Cosplay, here to talk to you about Sintra armor. Now, Sintra is an alternative that some people, including me, are using, an alternative to EVA foam or other types of crafting materials. It's not necessarily a replacement, it's just an alternative. What Sintra is it's a PVC sheet, similar to PVC pipe, but as it's manufactured, it's foamed. So it's lighter than a PVC pipe, it's less dense. It's still rigid as opposed to EVA foam, which is still kind of squishy. Even if you get the HD foam, the EVA foam is still kind of squishy or soft or will kink or whatever. By comparison, Sintra, even in its lightweight foam state, is hard and rigid and can take a beating. Mm-hmm. This has a lot of benefits. It has advantages, some of its benefits are it's super easy to paint, it's nice and durable, you don't have to worry about it getting squished, you can pile stuff on it once it's done, and you're not going to break it. And overall, I feel like it gives a more sturdy appearance and a sturdy aesthetic compared to EVA foam. Not saying that people aren't making amazing things out there with EVA foam, but this is just an alternative that I like. When you get EVA foam, or you can get it, it's used often for signs, retail signs, and retail displays and things like that. So you'll get it from either a local plastic shop. You can buy it online at ePlastics or Ridout Plastics or Tap Plastics, or look for a local sign shop, a local plastic shop. We have one here in Tampa that I go to called Plastics America, and they're going to have plenty of material for you in a variety of sizes and things. It goes by a few different names. Sintra is kind of the common name, but that's also a brand name like Kleenex. Other names are going to be Comatex or Celltech, or the one that's sold in big box hardware stores is Haylite Project PVC. But it's all essentially the same stuff. Sometimes it's slightly different densities, but it all works about the same. So most of the time, if you go to a plastic shop and ask for a PVC sheet, they'll know what you're looking for. So it comes in a sheet like this, or you can get it in sheets of up to 4 feet by 8 feet, or I'll get it in 2 foot by 4 feet pieces, and a piece like this is easy enough to stick in the back seat of your car, unless you have a big van or something that can take a 4 by 8 sheet home. You can also, if you're crafty, you can scavenge leftover retail signs. I used to work for Circle K, and when we changed over our signs, I said, hey, there's some Sintra that I can use to make some armor pieces. This quarter-inch thick Sintra used to have pictures of hot dogs on it, and now I think these pieces are now my face mask of my assault run up here.
Is it really that expensive?
It's not. It's a little more expensive than, say, floor mats. It's maybe comparable to some of the higher-end EVA foam. It's way less expensive than, say, Warbla, which is notoriously expensive for what you get. But it's not too expensive. Shipping can be a lot, as you might expect, for shipping a big 4-foot by 8-foot sheet. But it's not prohibitively expensive. I think the materials for the assault run over here were probably, I would guess, $100 in materials, maybe a little less, for just the PVC. And I had a lot left over to make smaller bits. I'm gonna touch a couple of times on safety of it. It is PVC. You don't want to burn it. If you burn PVC, you get chlorine gas, which nobody likes. So
no, in fact, I think it's against the Geneva Convention. In fact.
Yeah, so don't make yourself burn it. But if you look in your house, there's a bunch of stuff that's going to be toxic if you burn it. So just don't set it on fire. You'll be okay. You don't have to get it that hot to work with it. And we'll talk about that later. So conceptually, I'm not gonna go too deep into what can you make with it, because it's just a rigid crafting material that you can make into all sorts of stuff. We've got my bone armor over here that I carved, shaped and carved it, and painted it to look kind of like old rotten bones that were dragged out of the swamp. I've got some Wasteland stuff. I've got this forearm racer that I made that's rusty, gently paint swapped to the overhead. I've got my forearm racer that's all rusty and gross that I made out of PVC, and it weighs almost nothing. It's nice and sturdy. I've got my Star Wars armor that I showed off a little while ago for Kanan Jarrus from Star Wars Rebels. I've got one of the very first pieces that I did that's from the 1969 movie Barbarella, her tongue box, which she wears on her wrist. This is one of my very first Sintra pieces. So you can make, you're not restricted to just sci-fi armor. Sometimes I'll use it for brackets for holding pieces together. One of my other favorite props here I made, I've got a Mundi gun that shoots Hyperion Cash with my face on it. If you've ever played Borderlands, this is my more Borderlands Mundi gun. I pull the trigger, it'll spray cash everywhere. So this, I got a cheap Mundi shooting gun off of Amazon, and I made this thing out of PVC that'll slip on it and still allow me to shoot cash out in front of my Mundi gun. So this is all Sintra as well. So you can make all sorts of different stuff with it. I got some boot armor covers here. These were a quick and easy thing for Jennifer's Harrison to look. So make all sorts of things with it. If you're making something that's just in your head, then just go for it. You know what you want to make. It's in your head. If you're making something that's already exists in a video game or a movie or whatever, your first step, of course, is going to be to find as much reference material as you can. So print out all your reference material when you're working on this stuff. This goes for any kind of prop that you're making. I've got a whole stack here of reference pictures for the assault prop and all the different parts and details. Brit from Punished Props was kind and generous enough to send me all these images. I also took a zillion screenshots and kept them on my iPad so I can always have reference
material. You want me to play a video of what the Assaultron looks like?
Sure, Denver's got a little short video of the finished Assaultron since it's right off camera. I guess you can kind of see it over here. But she's got a little video of it in action. Probably get my next step up.
You guys have done more video work than we have, that's for sure.
This is
or almost as much as, we should say. It's like something straight out of a movie.
So there's my Assaultron in action, wearing that in a junkyard. So it's a lot of fun to wear. So building templates. Jennifer, if you can switch back
I'm coming back to you right now.
Everybody has a different way of building templates. If you watch some of the other prop builders like Comedy Cosplay or Punish Props or Evil Ted or anybody, everybody's got a different way to make their templates. The video that we just watched about making your fabric templates and your fabric patterns, a lot of that stuff will translate to making your armor patterns as well. A lot of those same concepts still apply. But my usual two methods are the duct tape method and the cardboard brute force method. If you watch some other armor makers, they'll show you how to make duct tape templates. So I'm not going to get too deep into that. But Jennifer, we've got some pictures of some of my duct tape templates that I was working on the Assaultron. Here I had one of my reference pictures. The Assaultron has nice thick thighs. I'm a skinny guy. So what I did is I padded out a body form. I made a body form for my lower half out of a duct tape and padded it out to be the right shape. And then I wrapped that shape with duct tape and drew on, Jennifer, you can click over to the next step. I drew on the outline of the armor. So from there, I could just cut the duct tape off with scissors and tip it back over here. And I've got my templates here for the side panels of the Assaultron. So I've got these. So that's one that is a pretty common way to do it. And I'm not going to go too much into detail with that, but that one is one that works for me half the time. These aren't always going to be perfect. Sometimes they are. You're still possibly going to have to tweak along the way, but it's a pretty tried and true method for making templates. My other one, actually, Jennifer, if you can show the next picture, That's the same method as what I did for this stealth armor helmet, which was we took a head form and I put the visor that was going to be part of the helmet, put it on the head form, wrapped it and padded it with plastic wrap and padded it out and then taped it up with tape and then drew on how I wanted the helmet to look. And then once I cut, grabbing the helmet from over here, they kind of handy. Cut off those tape pieces and flattened them out and made my tape templates. So flip back to the overhead. So I cut off all of my tape pieces and had my templates here. Mm-hmm. Used these templates to design my Sintra pieces and cut them out of Sintra, shaped them, which we'll get into in a little bit, and came up with this final helmet that was done. So there's a couple of ways of using your tape templates. The other thing that I like to do is just build something out of cardboard. Everybody's got cardboard, everybody's got Amazon boxes of some sort or shipping material. So I'll make stuff out of cardboard all the time, and I'll save my templates, either the cardboard ones or the paper versions of them. So should I go back to the
Do you keep a file or just a big box of them?
Once I'm done with the cardboard, I'll transfer it to paper, which is like these, and then store my somewhere around here. I've got a big envelope of my flat paper templates, so I can. I've got that one right here.
And then if someone wanted to maybe access them to make something similar, do you scan them and put them out as like part of project files or?
It's on my list of things to figure out how to do. Some of these things are big and I don't have a great way to do that yet. I'll be happy to do that once I figure out how, or I'll be happy to take advice from somebody that knows how to do that. I'll transfer them to paper. And this is about 5 costumes worth of paper templates in here. And I got them labeled and I write which year it was that I made it, and what material. Here's my bone armor templates here.
I'm gonna go overhead.
Whichever. Overhead. Bone armor templates here. That's just one of the Ziploc bag. That's all the bone ones that we were just looking at. Almost all the assault on is just in this stack here. It's not fancy, but that's the whole thing there. Mm-hmm. With the exception of some pieces that I just made by hand without going for a tender.
Question from the chat. How long did it take to build Assaultron?
About 4 months. And that was, I'm going to say probably 300 hours. That includes a lot of learning along the way.
Coming back to me.
Electronics in it. And some of the pieces are made using a vacuum former and styrene, the pieces that are hard to hand form. As part of that 4 months, I learned a ton along the way. I learned how to get into the electronics. I learned a lot of sewing and patterning, the sewing stuff. I did the full undersuit from scratch. The styrene and the vacuum former. If you want to learn how to do a vacuum former, look at Punish Prompts YouTube channel. I keep saying Punish Prompts because they're great. But they have a 2 or 3 part YouTube series on making your own homemade vacuum former. Cost me about $40 plus $40 in stuff plus the shop back that I already had. So satisfying to make these with the packing form. So look that up. It's super cool to make the
you can show the arm pieces to explain what you're talking about.
Oh yeah.
That'll help.
These domes, for instance, on the Assaultron shoulders, these domes would have been really hard to vacuum form. Or here on the sides of the head, these cups here would have been very hard to shape by hand with this kind of detail, but this bottom piece of the cup was relatively easy to vacuum form and a lot of fun to make. About 4 months, maybe 300 hours.
Wow.
So back to making templates. Making your templates takes some experience, but if you're working with cardboard, there's nothing loose. Everybody's got some cardboard sitting around the house. Or you can go and just get at your favorite retail store for some cardboard boxes. So I'm going to go through making a template for a forearm bracer that's kind of like a can endurance bracer that we were looking at, or that waistline bracer that we were looking at just a minute ago. And I got a template for these pretty quick. And then I, of course, saved it. So I've got my cheat sheet here in case I get off track. We can always pop back to my there.
Well, I'll also say that from a safety perspective, it's a lot better that you make this out of PVC or Sintra than using real metal. That's for sure, because that would be dangerous.
It's heavier, it's lighter, it's still pretty sturdy. Mm-hmm. I've dropped some pieces, and on the 20th drop, they finally broke. But it is pretty sturdy. Not as sturdy as metal, but a lot lighter, and yeah, definitely safer. I'm not gonna put myself and get tetanus from this rusty piece of stuff. It's all just decorative paint. Mm-hmm. So forearm bracer, gonna be a tube, more or less. So let's say my arm is that long. It's exactly one arm length long.
Be careful now.
Oh yeah, I've done this a few times. And if you don't have a cutting mat, this is one of my favorite tools. It's a cutting mat here and the regular box cutter with the changeable blades or snap-off blades. If you don't have a cutting mat, you can use some old scrap cardboard to use as your working mat, but I would definitely recommend getting your hands on one of these.
I just have a workbench with wood I don't care about.
If you don't cut yourself and bleed at least once during the costume, all right, so we've got a piece of cardboard here, and I'm going to roll it up into a tube.
I love this. We wouldn't be able to do this in a regular convention.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh, geez. I'm ruining my thing. Let's start over.
It's cardboard. Who cares?
Yeah, I'm a little enthusiastic here about my cardboard.
That's why I'm worried about you cutting yourself.
Yeah.
I'd be excited too. So do you have to follow the corrugation on the cardboard for that?
What was that, Marshall?
Do you have to follow the corrugation on the cardboard for that?
Using the thin, lightweight stuff, you can kind of go against it. But the more you work with it and beat it up, the more you can kind of go against it. It's not going to stretch too much, but I can bend it in the opposite way it can only bend. So as you're working with it, squish it, tweak it, mess with it, and eventually you'll be able to force it to go and do what you want to do. So this is not quite what we want. Right? It's there. It will stick on an arm, but it's kind of boring. And as you bend your arm here, I got it a little bit too long here. It's gonna run into my elbow here.
I'm gonna cut it to the wide shot so they can see where it's running. I'm cutting the wide so they can see where it's bending.
Yeah, as I bend it, it's gonna hit my elbow, the inside of my elbow, and that's gonna be really sore by the end of the day. It's also kind of close to where I'm just gonna bend. The back of the elbow there is just about right. So, my sharpener. Actually, I'm gonna take this on and kind of. We're taking cardboard. This is how I'm making things. I'm going to tape it to itself and not to my skin. Maybe I'll tape it to my skin.
So what gave you the idea to get into making PVC armor?
There's another builder that I follow, Johnny and Junkers Cosplay, or I think it goes by just Junkers Cosplay now, and he had been building some really cool stuff out of it, stuff that at the time was way better than any of the foam armor that I'd seen. And I really loved some of his builds. He made a full body guts from Berserk that just blew me away. And I was like, I've got to learn how to do this. And he was also very generous in making some of these things and documenting every step along the way and writing up a blog on every step and every article that he was doing. On his blog and read every post that he posted. I've got to give this a try. So got a small amount of material and gave it a shot. Did a couple of simple and easy things like the the Barbarella tongue box that and turned out pretty good. So made something a little more complex and a little more complex, and you know, a couple years go by and I keep making things, and I finally got a full suit of armor head to toe on. So it wasn't necessarily that I chose it over the VA foam or Warbler. It's just I saw another builder who had made it and said, yeah, that's the kind of stuff that I want to do. So I want this a little closer on, or a little more room on my wrist here. I want to have a little more room here. Probably would want to add. I didn't quite cut it big enough to cover the front of my arm here, so I'll probably want to add another 2 inches or so to here. So I'm gonna add, I'll make myself a note. Add 2 inches. So there's my first revision of my cardboard template, and I'll usually go through 2 or 3 or 4 of these, depending on how much of a concept I have for the thing that I'm doing. I'll do 2 or 3 or 4 or 6. My record is 6 revisions to the front camera.
Mm-hmm.
This insert on the assault on chest, this is probably the most complex piece that I've ever made or template by hand. And that's because it's out a little farther around here, but then this insert goes inside here closer to the center. So it's underneath, but also over, and it curves around in a weird way, and it's round on this side, flat on the front. So it took me, let's see if I have, I started out with a duct tape form that didn't work as well as I hoped. So we're 1, 3, 4, 5, I think they look very similar, but then by the time I get to number 6 was pretty close to the actual final template that I used, and I had a separate piece that goes around the outside to fill this in. So that was, if your first one doesn't work, it's just cardboard. Use what you learned from your first version and make another version.
Yeah, I know I recycle about half of my recycling bin every week's worth of it, so.
I've lost my scissors, sorry. And where I drew on this, I just kind of gave myself reference marks here where I was drawing, and I kind of remember what I wanted to do here. I know I want to add this to be a little farther out, and I don't want sharp points here, so I'm not going to cut this really sharp, but I know that I want it to come in kind of close like that.
Okay, we have a question from the chat. What's the best way to smooth seams between pieces?
Yeah, I'll get to that in just a minute. Okay. But the answer is...
I can show that picture, too.
Short answer is EpoxySculpt.
Say that again? You kind of broke up a little bit.
Jennifer, can you cut the overhead?
Yep. Ah. So, upside down, but...
There we go. EpoxySculpt. It's a two-part epoxy clay. You mix up one-to-one, knead it together like a little bit of clay, and squish it onto your seam, squish it down into the seam after your seam is glued together. Let it cure. It doesn't dry. It cures like epoxy. And then sand it.
I'm going to cut to Canaan.
This stuff will sand very similarly to the Sintra itself. So Patrick's seam epoxy sculpt. Jennifer, can you flip over to the Canaan photo that I gave you? This is my Star Wars Canon Jarrus armor, where I used it to make a nice smooth fillet between the neck guard and the shoulder guard. So this is what it looks like after it's done. Nice smooth seam there. Mash it down in there. If your fingers are a little wet, you can smooth it really easily with your fingers. And then you'll have a little less sanding to do.
Is that sign?
Smooth that down.
Yeah.
It is. It's Freddie, who's the voice of Canon Jarrus in Star Wars Rebels. We met at Star Wars Celebration a couple years ago. And same thing with the solar dome here. This one actually has a dart, six darts. One, two, oh, there we go. Here are my darts. So I've got a little bridge that's glued on, a little bridge just to reinforce it. Mm-hmm. So six darts. This is back when I was using hot glue. You can use high temp hot glue, or you can use CA glue, cyanoacrylate, with or without gap filler, depending on how well the pieces fit together. But good old high temp, not low temp, but high temp hot glue will work pretty well for CA glue is what you can use. But you can see my ugly seams on the bottom, but on the top, where I smooth them out with the epoxy sculpt and sanded them, and it might take two passes, sand it if it doesn't look good, then patch it up a little bit with some more epoxy sculpt, and sand it down some more. And then it's ready to prime and paint, use a little filler primer, and give it one more sand. But that's patching the seams. Oh, okay, yeah. Trying to stick to my time here. I'll give this one more pass here. Pretty close to having this wearable. I like how it fit on this side. And something else that I'll often do is give myself a little bit of overlap that I can trim off later.
Measure twice, cut once, or just cut big, and then you can cut again. But you can't cut it back on.
And as you get into more and more complex pieces, your patterns are going to start to look sometimes kind of ridiculous. I'll show you some of those other ones. This one is a pretty simple pattern. It's just a kind of conical shape that's going to fit on your forearm.
Anybody who's not a cosplayer, I'm sure, just laughed about that ridiculous comment, because that's a matter of perspective for sure.
It's ugly. If I wasn't on a time crunch here on my own schedule, I would smooth this out a little more so it wouldn't have all these bumps and bumps. But this is still fine for a fit test. I probably still need to add a little bit more on the back here. So this is getting pretty close to being able to fit on the forearm. So I probably want a little bit less here, or just leave that and fix the overlap later, and maybe a little more here. But that's pretty close. I've got this it's cut in a little bit here, so that when I fold my arm, it's not going to pinch me. I probably do want to make this one a little bit bigger. But you just keep going through until your cardboard piece fits the way that you want it to fit. And then if your cardboard piece fits properly, then you know your centerpiece is going to be pretty close. If you download somebody's templates, make it out of cardboard first. You don't want to sacrifice all your material and find out that maybe they were a size or three smaller or bigger than you, so you've got a piece of armor that doesn't fit right.
Or they scaled it wrong or something like that.
Maybe you paid for somebody's templates and they just weren't a very good template maker. And you cut all your material, and then it just doesn't fit. So make your things out of cardboard. If it doesn't work, make some adjustments and make it again. And go through a few different versions of your cardboard template before you cut into your material. So let's say I've gone through a couple of different versions of that, and I've got this forearm razor. I've got it smoothed out here. This razor, actually, this pattern was one that I made last time I gave this class, and that made this wasteland bracer here, which is not quite as junky as the previous one, but it's nice and comfortable. It's flared out a little bit at the wrist. Mm-hmm. Plenty of room for my arm there, so a little bit of extra armor at the elbow, and just on a whim, I drilled some holes in it and laced it up with some old twine. But once you have your basic shape down, you can add whatever you want to it. But I've got my forearm template here. I've also got a upper arm bracer. This is the template for Kanan's bicep armor. So so I'll show you how that fits as well. It's kind of a weird looking shape. Is that a high temperature? I added these extensions because I was making a copy of this for somebody else who's got bigger guns than me.
Which you can do that if you do it in cardboard first, too.
Yeah, so we made this and said, does this fit your arm? Is this good? And we fit it on his arm and it fit him well. So I then took this die and made it out of the PVC. Another wacky tempo is this one, for instance, is kind of a weird one when you first look at it, but actually it's just a modification of this regular forearm bracer. But for the Fallout Stealth Armor, the original design has this overlap here where the hand panel connects, and it's got this wire, it's got these double pieces. So going off the original reference material, how do we make this work? And it's by doing this on the my cardboard template. And I transferred it to paper to store this in cardboard. If you're cutting darts, you're going to have some weird stuff like this. This B, as we assemble it, we're going to close it down. Like if you made things out of fabric, and your fabric doesn't stretch, you need it to make it to a dome shape, you cut your dart, and then you're going to glue it or stick it together to get a nice dome shape. And the paper one doesn't look quite that good, but if you make it out of cardboard, it's okay, and then if you make it out of Sintra, you can massage it a little more.
Question from the chat. What temperatures are needed to mold or vacuum form this material?
Yeah, that's 2 steps away. It's just a heat gun. Burned 2 Harbor Freight heat guns and finally got a Wagner brand. So I've got a Wagner Furno 300, which is a great name for a tool, Furno 300. So just a regular heat gun. This is all I use for everything for hand shaping. For vacuum forming, that's a whole different ball of wax that I'm not going to get into right now, but for hand shaping, just an off-the-shelf heat gun.
Could you use a hairdryer?
You might be able to work with some of the 3mm thick stuff with a hairdryer. I don't think it would get hot enough. I think you'd be constantly struggling with keeping your material hot enough to form it without it cooling back down to the temperature before you shape. I don't want to say don't try. If you have an industrial hairdryer that's a high-end one, then maybe. But I have not ever tried with a hairdryer. I don't think it would get hot enough.
Okay.
Here's one other weirdo template here that I want to show you before I get to cut. And this is the biceps for the Assaultron. You can kind of see the equipped to the other camera, the main camera. So you can see these kind of have a weird shape. Everything snaps together, so I'll get into that. Time for me in a little bit as well. So this bicep is kind of a weird shape. Again, it's similar to that the plain bicep that I was showing you just a minute ago, but it's got this extension here that I bolt the elbow detail onto, and it's also got this flare out here at the top. So I've made it into 2 pieces like this, and it took me a pretty few times to get this in right, but pretty happy with it. Now that's my elbow. And this next little piece is going to go on there, and when I glue those pieces together like that, I've got the nice little flare out on the top. So you wind up with some weirder looking patterns. But let's say that I went through all of these and I came up with this forearm bracer that I'm ready to make. Got my material here. I usually work with either a 3mm, which is an 1/8 inch thick, or a 6mm, which is 1/4 inch thick. The 6mm is way sturdier, but it's also a little more difficult to work with. It takes more time to get it up to temperature to heat it. You can cut it with a box cutter, but most of the time I use a jigsaw, so it needs a little more cleanup along the edges. So if you're making pieces that need to feel thick and sturdy and you have the tools to do it, then yeah, play with the 6mm 1/4 inch stuff. It's going to feel nice and sturdy. The 1/8 inch 3mm is going to be way easier to work with. So I've got my piece here. I'm going to give it a quick outline. That's that. And this is everything stuff. I'm just going to use my hand box cutter, scrubby table, and a cutting mat. You can cut it with a big piece of cardboard instead of a cutting mat, but if you're going to be doing a lot of the stuff, get your hands on a piece of cutting mat. If you can do this in a single pass, then great. Sometimes I'll do two passes. Please don't cut yourself following my instructions. I've managed to never cut myself during this step. Knock on wood. Now watch me do it. During we're doing it live.
Patience. Slow is smooth. Smooth is fast, as we say in the military. Yeah, my creative director, who's a combat camera photographer, is laughing.
Actually, don't watch me cut myself here.
Reminds me of almost like glasswork. My father used to do and still does stained glass work.
Yeah. Once you've got your score mark there, you can finish it up.
Oh, can't do that with glass.
A little bit of effort there to it. But just take your time. If you need to make a couple of passes, that's fine. Unlike EVA foam, with EVA foam, you want to make sure to get it all done in a single pass. Otherwise, your edge is going to be super janky. But the Sintra is a little more forgiving in that we can go over this easily with sandpaper. One of the things that I like about the Sintra compared to EVA foam is you can sand it really easily. You can cover your mistakes with a lot of epoxy sculpt, or you can just sand it. Whereas with EVA foam, it's maybe a little harder to hide your mistakes. So if you don't get your first, if you're cutting your EVA foam and you don't get all the way through on your first pass, you're going to have that ugly edge. It's going to be hard to glue, or it's just going to look bad, or it's going to take more effort to clean it up with your
Well, there's that wide shot. I like that.
Oh yeah, camera 3. Thank you.
I figured same. Since you're doing the same thing, I'll give you a wide shot.
Is that a 3D printer behind you?
Two of them.
Yeah, we've got a.
Right. So you could have stood in for a 3D printing panel earlier.
We talked about the masks.
Our 3D printer, aside from turning it off so it's quiet during this panel, if you have a 3D printer, here's a shameless plug for what we're doing. We're printing nonstop face sheets for our local medical professionals. I know a lot of people are printing their masks, but the masks have a lot of
legal
issues. They're really filtering as well as N95 masks. But we've been creating these little frames. These little tiny frame pieces that are a few grams of filament, only a few minutes to print, and they give you a lot of wear in the ball cap. You put a piece of plastic on there, and now you have. And it's not going to replace any medical grade equipment, but it's going to. It's almost as good as the actual medical grade face shield, which are in very short supply. So if you have a 3D printer,
reach out to us and we can put you in touch
with help. And we will point you to the files that you need and some organization groups so you can help us with some of these face shields to get us to the testing centers and to the ERs and everybody who needs this kind of protection.
I love this. This is exactly why we're doing this type of thing.
Exactly. It's. People like to print their masks, but the masks take hours to print, and who knows if they're actually effective or not, whereas these take, with my close-to-stock Creality, it's 35 minutes to print one, 13 grams of filament, so I get 70 of them done with a single roll of filament and help that many more people. And then, nothing against the people that print the face masks.
It's nothing. But
we've given away about... How many, Jennifer? About 60 so far.
Yeah, and we've got about 500 coming up this week.
We've got hopefully 500 we'll be able to hand out by the end of this weekend. We got a big box of them assembling later tonight to give away tomorrow. So if you have a 3D printer and you want to contribute to something that actually is pretty meaningful, then
reach out to us.
Yeah, reach out. Okay, so I've got my piece cut out. I'm going to clean up the edges a little bit here, and I'm not going to cut my thumb.
We don't recommend doing it this way.
Yeah, I wouldn't recommend doing it this way. If you have a Dremel, you can put on your mask and eye protection and then use a Dremel with a sanding drum and go on the edges here.
It's really tough to cut yourself that way. I'll vouch for that as a wood carver.
So just like put it on the pieces. So now we've got this piece that's pretty close to being what I want. And now it's time to put the decal to it. One of the things that I like to do when I'm running the heat gun is, again, cardboard box. Just by putting this piece in a cardboard box on my work surface, it's going to contain the heat a little more and make kind of a little, not really an oven, but it's going to contain the heat so that this whole piece heats up a lot more quickly. Now, we're going to be careful with heating it. Like I mentioned earlier today, it's bad for you if you burn it. If your piece starts to discolor like this, if your piece starts to discolor at all, you've gone way too far. If you start feeling any surface texture, any little bubbles on the surface, take the heat away, you're going too far. I went outside to do this and had my respirator on, but if it looks like this, you're making corn gas and it's not what you're doing. But it doesn't take that much. You're going to heat it until it feels like stale washed on it, and that's all you need. It doesn't take long, especially on the thin stuff. On the thicker stuff, it does take a little bit of time. But I'm going to sit in a box here. I'm going to give it some even heat. I know I want to bend it in this direction, so I'm going to kind of heat it along the middle here and then fine-tune the long ends here. Maybe I'll do the edges first. Yeah, that's what I'll do. I'm going to do one of the edges. Hopefully you can still hear me over the heat gun.
We can.
And a little bit, flip it over, heat up the other side just a little bit. If you're very sensitive to heat, you may want to wear gloves. I know war glove needs a much lower forming temperature than this. It takes a little more heat than war glove, but still not so much that you're going to burn yourself on it. But if you're very sensitive to heat, you can put on some.
Yeah, somebody in the chat mentioned fireplace gloves.
Yeah, fireplace gloves. I like to have the feel of it, I guess. Just that little bit of it. Now we're already starting to get it into the curve shape. And as this cools back down to room temperature, it's going to be just as rigid as it originally was. Mm-hmm. So we're just going to keep going through the rest of it.
So can you reheat it and then unheat it and then reheat it, or does it get to a certain point where it'll break or something like that as you bend it?
Some people say it does degrade if you reheat too many times. I've never really run into that myself. As long as you don't get it to that degradation temperature, as long as you haven't gotten it to where the surface starts to bubble up, I don't think you take it too far. I'm not a materials engineer. I'll be happy to point you to the MSDS for the manufacturer, and you can look at it yourself. There we go.
Oh, yeah. It's like working with regular foam.
Yeah, at this point, it's very similar to foam. And I'm going to switch to the bottom edge there on the table. Kind of line those up.
By the way, our social media account posted your Facebook in case anybody wants to reach out to contact you for the 3D printing,
right.
Face mask holders, yep. Or anything like that.
Thank you.
And this step does take some experience and finesse. I'm actually kind of surprised myself that I got it this good on my first try. So don't expect it to turn out like this on the very first piece you make. You might have to scrap it and start over if you've gone too many times and it's just got completely out of hand. I got pretty close here on my very the very first heat and form. But you know what? You got to make some shitty stuff before you can make some great stuff. So make some things that are just basic pieces. Make some forearm bracers. Make some really simple pieces. Screw them up. If all else fails, turn them into Wasteland kit, because Wasteland.
Yeah.
So I didn't mark the top and bottom on this one, so I wound up making this one for my right arm, where the previous one was for my left arm. The next step that I would do, this one has a bigger gap here. This one, the new one, I may have made it a little tight, so I might need to heat it back up and loosen it. That's a little snug there. But not too bad. I could probably take these front edges here and tighten these down a little bit.
12 minutes.
I could probably tighten these down a little bit. And I could probably loosen this up a little bit, but that's pretty close. But if I wanted to make any more fine-tune adjustments, just put the heat gun to it again, just enough that you can start to bend it. Don't try to bend it if it's not heated, because it will break, because now it's hard plastic, so if you bend it in your hard plastic, it can break. But that's pretty much it. I got a forearm bracer now that is ready for cleanup and paint. So, next thing that I'm going to do, these edges that I just cut are pretty sharp. That was pretty uncomfortable taking it off my hand there. Mm-hmm. So, get at it with the knife again. Clean up these raw edges here. Get to it with sandpaper. Get to it with your sanding gum. Just smooth out these edges here so that's going to feel okay on your skin. You'll notice that the edges curl and kind of flare out a little bit. So it's going to be even sharper than it was when I first cut it. But you can just get in there with your knife, your sandpaper, your file, and just smooth it out. It's got the same file very similarly to the absolute. From here, you can work on decorating it however you want. You can glue some extra stuff to it. You can rivet things to it. You can, if you have the thicker stuff, you can drill into it. For this piece, I did some pop rivets. So I just drilled some holes and just did some pop rivets to attach these extra pieces. If you have other pieces that you want to glue, again, high temp hot glue or cyanoacrylate, crazy glue. You can put your gemstones on it. You can punch little holes in it to attach extra little pieces to it.
Add a fancy light.
What's that, Jennifer?
Add a fancy light if you hit it.
Yeah, add a fancy light.
So question from the chat. How do I keep my armor, or keep armor that goes around the torso from being knocked down by my arms?
I don't really get the question, but strap it together. So you're going to attach your armor to your body somehow. I've taken some advice from the guys that make the Stormtrooper armor, guy who knows that makes Stormtrooper armor from the 501st, and I'm using snaps and straps and elastic and parachute buckles. So maybe that overhead cam there. So just about all of my big armor pieces I put together with snaps and parachute buckles and straps. These snaps, you can use the Dritz heavy duty snaps or from Candy Leather, the Line 24 or Line 20 snaps. So I've got my strap here, I've got my snap set in the strap, I've got another little length of strap that's glued to the inside of the armor, and I just snap there, and that's ready to go around my, just my thigh plate, ready to go around my thigh, and parachute buckle in place. This got two straps because that's the character design. This one's got a little bit of elastic on it, just to give me a little more flexibility. And one of the things that I love about doing it with a single snap on the end of the strap is that it can pivot. So from here, the top of my thigh plate, I've got this one vertical strap that pivots there, and another snap on the other end. This snaps to the inside of my belt. So it can pivot at my hip in two different places, pivot at the hip and pivot at the thigh. So it's very flexible with my body. For the top half of the armor, Jennifer's other character. I've got a chest plate, I've got a back plate, and I've got, very similar to that, I've got straps that go like suspenders over the tops of the shoulders. And in the side, in the top of the strap here, there's an additional snap that I have, an additional snap that goes down the length of the arm all the way down underneath the shoulder belt, down the bicep, that snaps into this strap that goes over the top of the shoulder. So all the way to the torso and the shoulders and the biceps is on these straps that go over the top of my shoulders. And then more straps and straps on the inside of the arms there. My belt is, I've got elastic here, so I can put the belt on and off pretty easily. Just slide it up and snap the cuff piece on to hold it to keep it from stretching out anymore. Does that answer the question of how do you keep things?
I think you went above and beyond, my friend.
So that was one of the things that I wanted to get to later is snapping and strapping your armor together.
The magnets.
Get your hands on this webbing, cheap on Amazon, cheap from Tandy. This either poly webbing or cotton webbing. I like the feel of the cotton webbing a little more, but it's hard to keep the ends of it clean. You can't just take a lighter and burn the ends of it. Whereas with the poly webbing or the nylon webbing, it's essentially the same stuff, but since it's plastic, essentially you can get a lighter and just go along the edges of it to keep the edges of the strap clean. But set your snap in a length of this, do it to the inside of the armor, and snap your other strap to that. That makes a nice sturdy yet flexible attachment.
You actually just answered another question in the chat. Good job.
Okay, good. That gluing it to the how do you set through the armor? Yeah, a little strap of the nylon webbing and some CA glue. Glue it on before you paint, so you're not gluing to paint. You're gluing to the plastic itself. And don't paint your snaps, or they're not going to snap very well. You're going to have to get in there with sandpaper and clean the paint off to make your snaps look like you're supposed to again. I learned just the hard way.
And you mentioned hot glue before. Is that hot glue as well?
This is almost all cyanoacrylate glue, and just about all CA glue. I've also used a lot of magnets on the Assaultron. So on the helmet, the face. Let's see if I can do this without knocking my earbuds out. Yeah, the helmet there and the mask snaps on and off with magnets, and the ear caps with magnets. So if these get bumped as I walk through the door, the top antenna with magnets. So just glue some magnets to stuff. In this case, I've got the magnets that are screwed in, the double tape magnets with screw. So magnets and straps and snaps is how I keep it. I want to do more and more magnets. Also the claws, this is one of my favorite things. Sometimes you want your costume hands, but sometimes you need people hands to pull a drink or get out your cash or your phone. So on my belt, I have a strong magnet here on the belt and a strong magnet here on the wrist of my gauntlet. So when I'm ready to have a regular hand again, I just snap that to my belt and pull my hand out, and then I have a hand. When I'm ready to costume back up, I just slip my hand into it and have a claw ready again. So back to keep your accessories attached to your body just like that. One of the other things, my electronic control box, I've got magnets to hold this control, hold this panel in place. So I've got my audio box under there with switch and volume, and everything just snaps in place. Painting, real quick, once you've sanded, cleaned up your edges, and glued all your stuff together, and done your epoxy sculpt on your seam, it's ready to paint. You don't have to heat seal it like even foam. This is one of my favorite things compared to EVA. You don't have to seal it, you don't have to plastic dip it. This is ready for paint. Sometimes I'll be primer. Sometimes I won't if I'm doing just kind of a one-off piece. I like the Rust-Oleum filler primer. I did some samples here. Original unpainted piece and the gray Rust-Oleum filler primer. If you're doing a big project that's important to you, go ahead and prime all your pieces, especially using the filler primer, which will let you sand down and hide any imperfections. manufacturing. If you want pieces that look like old metal, this material is also one of my favorite things. 99 cents from Lowe's.
Flip them over.
Sorry. 99 cents from Lowe's. It's product source, flat black. It's blade. Their gloss colors are not good. They have gloss white, gloss black, and flat black. The flat black is fantastic. So,
2 minute warning, my friend. 2 minute warning.
So, flat black, if you dust that with a little bit of just a teeny tiny dusting of metallic silver, then you get this this metal look that looks kind of like oil steel. Mm-hmm. So, super easy way to get this steel look. Do your flat black, then hold your piece of arm's length and just go a couple of light dusts with the metallic. You're not painting it, you're just getting a little bit of dust on there to get the metallic look. And one other thing, all my battle damage, like you've seen on some of these pieces, paint your base coat, then dab it with a little bit of liquid latex, either on a Q-tip or a rag or a thumb, then do your color coat, and then you can wipe off that liquid latex, and you have real
paint chipping. Wow.
So I did the primer. Normally I would do like a real kind of metal looking coat, which is what I did on the Assault on. Mm-hmm. Here, just did a great primer and just got some regular liquid latex.
Mm-hmm. Upsetting.
Liquid latex and just dab it on a little bit. Don't do too much, but that's all it takes.
Okay, unfortunately, so, we are just about out of time, so 20 seconds, final thoughts.
If you got any questions, please feel free to reach out to me on our Facebook page or any of our social media. We're No Sweet Tool Cosplay on any of those social media. I'm happy to give you pictures or write you 6 paragraphs about how I do things. We have a ton of documentary on not just this stuff, but all our other things that we built. Jennifer's got giant 16-foot moving articulated Maleficent wings. So go check those out. We're super proud of those. And we're actually built for 2019 and lots of cool stuff coming up for 2020. So thanks everyone for tuning in.
Thank you, and thank you for what you're doing with your 3D printer with the face masks. All right, we're going to go ahead and transition to the con lobby here.